Okay, here we go. To the saints. Everybody say, to the saints. Thank you. We are going through the book of Ephesians. It's Paul's letter to the people living in the city of Ephesus. We're going through it verse by verse. It's a series that we've entitled In Him, because in that book of the Bible, in him is mentioned over 20 times. And I want to take the next year, literally 2017, to walk you through this wonderful book. We are only in verse 1 of chapter 1 and already on message number 3. We have 5 messages coming out of just the first verse. There are so many that you need to hear from this. I've been so blessed. And so this whole year, read the book of Ephesians. Start chapter by chapter, read through it. If you're like me and you like to exercise, put on the audio Bible. I listen to the audio book of Ephesians within about 25, 30 minutes. I'll just put it on repeat, keep going through it, and it blesses me every time because it gives me new nuggies. Now today what we're going to talk about is to the saints. Say it again with me, to the saints. Thank you. We're going to learn about who Paul believed the church was, who the Christians were in this city. Look at it there in the NIV, the version that we've been reading out of, more of a contemporary version. It says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to God's what? Holy people. Everybody say holy people. Thank you. To God's who? Holy people. Thank you. In Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now remember, the NIV is a more modern translation. So let's look to the King James Version. And I actually have the new King James Version up here that removes the these and thous, but it keeps it more old school. Now listen to that word, holy people, in the King James Version here. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, pretty much the same, to the what? The saints. Everybody say the saints. To the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. To the saints. Does that sound like today's message title? Now, where do you think the saints are today? Where do you think the saints are? Point to where the saints are at. They're right here. They're not in heaven necessarily, though if we have died and we're in heaven, we're there. But that's not who Paul was talking to. He wasn't talking to Christians in heaven. Who he was talking to were the Christians in the church, and he called them saints. Now we have to sit back and understand there's been some differences that different churches have taught about when it comes to saints. So don't get mad at me, get mad at Paul, but I got to tell you the truth. Look at your neighbor and say, here it comes. Okay, so understanding who the biblical saints are and what their nature is really like is one of the most difficult subjects I, as a pastor in this church, ever have to deal with. Why do I have a difficult time dealing with the subject of saints? Why? Because there's two false misunderstandings. The first misunderstanding of saints, which most people think of, are saints being dead, super Christians who are now worthy of our prayers and our adoration. Like we're supposed to pray to them and we're supposed to worship them in some way. How many have heard about that way of looking at saints? Come on, raise your hands. You have family that have taught you that saint so-and-so, the patron saint of lost things. And if that was true, my wife would need that saint's help because my wife loses things all the time, and I love you so much. I would probably need the saint of loving your wife and not embarrassing her in church. I would need that saint's help. But where is that in the Bible? Show me one place in the Bible where we as Christians are told to pray to someone other than God, where the saints are super Christians that we are supposed to ask for help, or we're supposed to make statues out of and put them in our car. How many have ever seen somebody put the saint of safety in their car or whatever, safe travels, you know? I don't want to embarrass you, but some of you know who that saint is, and I could say, who knows, and you'd shout it out, then everybody would look at you and laugh, but I don't want to do that. But you know what saint I'm talking about, because I forgot. But that saint that goes right there in the middle, and we think to ourselves that that's what saints are. But we ask our friends and family, and I have family that believes that way too, but I just ask them, show me in the Bible where that's at. They can't show me. They can't show me one place in heaven where saints are being prayed to. They can't show me that. But every place Paul writes to the church of people who are living, he calls those people saints. Let's go back, and just in case you're already getting mad at me, going, I don't know if I, well, you mad, I'm upset with you. Grandma taught me about St. Anthony, and I believe in that. I don't care what this pastor says. Gosh darn it. I'm mad. Mad. Okay, get mad then, but get right after you get mad. Okay, get right after you get mad. Paul, an apostle, I think he knows what he's talking about. He's the guy writing the Bible to us, of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the who are in heaven, who are receiving our prayers, who are going to be gold medallions on our necklaces, and we'll kiss. Is that who they're, is that what it says? To the saints who are in, where are they in? Ephesus. They're right there. They're in a city. Hey, you're a saint. You're a saint. I'm writing to you. Now, some of you may say, I ain't no saint. That's true, because there are people who are ain'ts. So you are either a saint or an ain't. And how do you know you ain't a saint? Is if you're not born again. If you ain't born again, you ain't no saint. So if you're saying to me, well, I ain't no saint, I'll just say amen. But I know there are saints in this place. I know there are people who are the saints. And I want to build a church of more saints than ain'ts. Okay, amen. You understand my grammar here a little bit. It's all right if I get a little hood on you, get a little southern. I used to live in New Orleans, okay, y'all? So there are some saints and there's some ain'ts. How do you become a saint? Well, you become born again. And then that's where we get into the other confusion, is because, like I said at the beginning, there's two things that are confusing about saints. Now, the first one we just talked about, mostly in Roman Catholicism, that says saints are super-duper Christians that are now dead that we pray to and ask for help. But on the other hand, there's many people like Christians like this who come to churches just like ours who struggle with them identifying personally as saints because they don't want to believe that they are holy or righteous or perfect in Christ. And they'll say, well, you know, I ain't no saint, but I love Jesus. And, you know, I make mistakes all the time and nobody's perfect. And so what they do is they let their struggles with sin redefine who God says they are. So it would be like my son doing something that he shouldn't do, and then him now saying, well, I guess I'm not a Wyrostic anymore. I guess I don't act like daddy. I'm not worthy of that name. And he may think that's humble, but that's actually being rebellious. Because you are a Wyrostic. You have my DNA on the inside of you. When you say you are not that, you're not acting humble. You're being dumb on purpose, and I pity the fool. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, the pastor pity the fool. So when I meet Christians, when they say, well, I'm not, you know, I love Jesus, but I got all these imperfections and all these things. God's still working on me. Don't follow me. Just follow Jesus because I'll let you down. I just want to look at them and I want to go, stupid is, stupid does. The reason why you're so messed up and jacked up is because you don't know who you are. If you just knew who you were in Christ, you would act like who you're supposed to be. Now, some of you fall into this category right now, and you make excuses, and you say, no one's perfect, we're all sinners, and God loves me just the way that I am. And that's true, in a sense, before we meet Jesus, we're all messed up, we're all sinners, and God loves us just the way that we are. But that's not who Paul writes to. Paul doesn't say, I'm writing to all the messed up sinners that are all just tore up from the floor up, needing a checkup from the neck up. They stank with a bad attitude. I'm writing to all these messy people, to all these hypocrites. Is that who he said he's writing to? He said, I am writing to the saints. So you're going to argue with Paul? So be honest. If you've been born again, you need to stop saying I'm just a sinner. You need to stop saying that I haven't been made perfect in Christ. You need to stop saying that God loves me just the way that I am. He loves you just the way that you are, but too much to let you stay that way. Yes, I love my daughter even though she poops on herself. My 6-month-old daughter, I love her just the way she is with poopy diapers. But I love her too much to let her stay that way. Do you understand the difference? We call that humility, but that's pride. Don't stay with your stinky diapers. Let God change you and rearrange you. Now, the problem is that a lot of you listen to good radio stations like K-Love and Moody and all of this, and Moody be teaching you stuff that's booty. I love Moody when it gets right, but sometimes Moody be doing booty stuff. It be doing all the wrong stuff, and it gets you thinking you just messed up all the time. You're just a poor little old sinner, just barely making it. It's almost like an old country song. There's a tear in my beer, and I'm missing you, dear. It's like, dear God, what happened to you? Your dog dies. Your wife left you. Nobody likes you at that bar. Sometimes you listen to these Christian songs, and it's like, what are you on, Prozac? What's wrong? You're so depressed? Dear God, read the Bible, my friends. So, okay, love needs to love themselves some Bible. But here's an example of what you'll hear, and then you'll bring this nonsense into church thinking this is sound doctrine. This is K-Love's song, Broken Together. Just broken together. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams, I'll bring mine. Could healing still be spoken and save us? I don't know. The only way we'll last forever is if we're broken together. Dear God, no. No, Kayla, I ain't got no love for that nonsense. That's not what the Bible says. Somebody say, tell me what the B-I-B-L-E says. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that, yes, there's brokenness, but brokenness for sin. Brokenness because of pain, but Jesus came to heal you. Listen to what Isaiah wrote. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. God's got good news for the poor today. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. He's got good news for those who are broken today. You don't got to be broke no more. Amen. You don't got to be broke no more. Why are you still busted and disgusted? Why you still got shattered dreams? You hadn't met Jesus yet. Because Jesus will fix your shattered dreams. Jesus will fix your shattered life. But the problem is some of you want to use that as an excuse so you can just be little old, you know, limping along sinner and feel sorry for yourself. And you're just so broken and you want to meet another broken person. And we'll put our broken pieces together. We'll put our broken pieces together. What's wrong with you? Stop being broken. Come to Jesus, the healer of broken hearts. Amen. That's what Jesus will do for you. He came to proclaim freedom for the captives. No, I just want to stay locked up in porn. I just want to stay locked up in a bad attitude. Jesus, don't you let me out of here. I want to stay right here. And he's like, I came to tell you to be free. Get out of your jail cell of sin. Get out of your jail cell of depression. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Release from darkness for the prisoners. Proclaim the year's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God. That means God is going to whoop the devil. To comfort all those who mourn, to provide for those who grieve in Zion. Now look at this, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. Can we be beautiful together? Yes, we can, baby. Can we be beautiful together? We'll bring God our broken dreams and our broken life and be healed and come together whole. Amen. And receive a crown instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Monday doesn't have to be bad for you. Stop letting Monday pimp you. Stop worshiping coffee. Coffee ain't your God. And there ain't nothing wrong with Monday. There's something wrong with you. Wake up tomorrow praising Jesus. You tell yourself what kind of day it's going to be. Glory to God, I didn't make this day, so I don't got the right to complain about this day. The Lord has made this day, and I will be glad and rejoice in it. Amen? Now, it's okay you drink coffee. That's fine, but you don't need coffee. What you need is the joy of the Lord. You need a reason to get up in the morning and smile. To bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. Somebody send that to Casting Crowns and tell them write a song about that. Put that in your song and smoke it. Amen? Therefore, the truth is, somebody say the truth is. Thank you. The truth is that the saints, the Bible talks about, are living disciples of Christ. We're here today. We're living disciples of Christ, and we've been regenerated to be perfect, holy, and righteous. It was always the Father's plan to make Jesus the firstborn again among many brothers and sisters so we could live like him in this world. Look at Romans chapter 8, because a lot of you go, well, there's nobody like Jesus. Do you know why Jesus came down to die on the cross, why we wear this cross? So that he could give us all what he has, so that we could share in his nature. Look at it. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed, to be changed to the image of his Son. You are to be changed as you are born again into the image of Jesus Christ. That's what this represents. The baptismal tank today represents the birth canal of a woman. The water breaks, the child comes out. You are to be this represents that you are a new creation, not the same anymore. You were born once a sinner, now born again a saint, so that he could be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Now, let me tell you why a lot of churches don't want to tell you this. The reason why they don't want to tell you this is because the pastor's jacked up too. And as long as he's messed up, you're messed up, y'all get along really good. But you see, the moment the pastor gets serious about who his identity in Christ is, he's going to get serious about your identity. I don't want to keep you on the plantation of sin so I can share crop you and just make money off telling you every week you can make it out of your troubles. I want you to put your troubles under your feet, pimp slap the devil, and live like a conqueror. I haven't come here to be your pep talk every single week. Are you listening to me? And the reason why they do that is so they can keep you on the plantation of sin. Have you come back and hear Bishop so-and-so sets you free, get you excited, sing you a song, because you get beat up by the devil 6 days a week. It's about time you know your identity in Christ so that you can be a terror to the devil, a threat to the enemy. Take back what the devil stole from you. You don't need me to pep talk you. Look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm made in the image of God. God lives on the inner side of me, and I'm a light in this world, a salt to these people, and I'm not who I used to be. Amen. You look at yourself and tell yourself that every day. God's word will not return void. You will live according to what you believe and what you confess. Amen. So I didn't come here to make myself your coach every week to pep talk you. I came to teach you and train you in the word of God so you could be the saint the Lord called you to be. Amen. It's easy to preach to sinners and keep them sinners all the time because then the pastor looks like he's a superhero. But you know what? I'm not here to do that. I'm here to teach you to have everything God told you to have. Paul called you a saint. He said, walk accordingly. Walk worthy of your calling. Know who you are. That's what I say to my son. I don't say to my son, now be somebody else and then come back and be a Y-Rostic. I say, no, you are a Y-Rostic. Now act like a Y-Rostic. Draw forth from what you've been given from your mom and dad and God in this DNA. Draw forth from the resources you already have and have a good attitude. Put a smile on your face. Listen to your mom and dad. I don't tell him that he's a filthy, dirty, rotten kid, don't belong to this house. I tell him who he is. I show him what God has given him, the talents and the abilities. And when he believes who God made him to be, he will be all that God called him to be. This is what John wrote. Some of you might find this scandalous, but I'll tell you what, it's the truth. This is what John wrote. This is how love is made complete among us, that we may have confidence on the day of judgment. I'm confident for the day of judgment. Are you? Some of you aren't confident because you ain't a saint. That's why you're not confident. You know you're going to bust hell wide open. You are scared, and you have a reason to be scared. But there are some of you Christians who deal with condemnation. You need to stop being scared. Perfect love will drive out that condemnation. The reason why you're scared as a Christian is because you think you have to do more to be more, do more to be more. You're not confident in who you already are in Christ. John says, we know that God loves us, and we have this confidence on judgment day in this world, we are like Jesus. In this world, we are not like Donald Trump. We are not like Hillary Clinton. We are not like Oprah Winfrey. We are not like Lil Wayne. We are not like LeBron James. In this world, we are like Jesus. Do you believe that today? That's what this is supposed to mean. This is what that's supposed to mean. Is you're born again to live like Jesus, a brand new creation. Somebody say, make it plain. Look at your neighbor and say, that was just the introduction. You know I'm not even lying. That's just the introduction. I got a lot of stuff to go through. Can I just show you where we got to go today? We got to cover all this today. We got so much we have to do. I got to go through these two charts again. I got to review a bunch of these things with you right here. I got to tell you all this stuff right here. And then we're going to end with something that's going to blow your mind. This little poem right here. I haven't got time to show that to you, but it's a little poem. But anyways, I got to start you up right here. Somebody say, that was just the introduction. The definition of the Greek word hagios is the word saint, and it means holy, pure, consecrated, dedicated to God, most holy one, or God's holy people. That's what that word means. The New Testament was written in the Greek language, hagios. Everybody say hagios. Thank you. It means holy. That's exactly what it means. That's why when you look at the different translations here, the new version just says holy people. The older translation says saint, but it's the same Greek word, hagios, and it means holy, consecrated. Paul used this word over 20 times just within the epistle we're studying right now. Just in Ephesians, in the letters just that Paul wrote, he used it 20 times, and 9 times just in the book of Ephesians. You can see it all throughout it. So you see it in verse 1. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. You can see him say it again. He says, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you." And that scripture right there, that word, God's people, look at it again in the older translation. We need to understand that that word hagios doesn't change. It's just the translator trying to help you understand it. But I wish they would put it in there. Amen. I wish the more modern version would keep it in there. It says your love toward all the saints. All the saints. Let me just give you another example. Also in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18. He just says it a few verses down from here. He says that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance among the what? The saints. He says it over and over. 9 times in this letter alone, 20 times in his letters. It's an important concept. If you want to look at the other letters that he writes, look at Romans. Look at Corinthians. That's how he calls his people. As a matter of fact, look at it just as he started the book of Romans, he starts the book of Corinthians. He says here, "To the church of God which is at Corinth, to those who are sanctified," somebody say sanctified, "in Christ Jesus," thank you, called to be. So who are you? Are you a saint or an ain't? See, just know in your heart, when you say I ain't, that already tells you who you are. If you are arguing with me in your mind right now, listen to me. I agree with you. You ain't a saint. If you're like, man, that's not me. Who does this preacher think he's calling a saint? I ain't. Amen. Then get born again. Because the only ones who go to heaven, I'm not happy you're not a saint, but I'm happy you're realizing it. Only those who go to heaven are the saints. The church was made out of saints. There's not second-class citizens in the church. There's not another kind of Christian. There's not another kind of disciple. It's either saints or ain'ts. That's it. So stop arguing with God. If you ain't a saint, repent and say, I need to be one. Say, I repent for not being one. I'm stop making my excuses. Somebody say amen. Amen. And then when we see the saints in heaven, who are they? Are they special, super-duper Christians? No, they are us in heaven. Those of us who have died. If I were to die today and be in heaven, I would be a saint in heaven. But I'm on earth, so I'm a saint on earth. Same thing with all of you. If you're on earth today, you're a saint on earth. If you die, you go to heaven, you're a saint in heaven. One of the places that the Roman Catholic Church tries to confuse you is to have you look at Revelation chapter 8, verse 3, and I'll let you read it, and I'll see if you catch it yourself. Then another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. This is a picture of heaven. He was given much incense that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. So here is a throne. All the prayers of the saints are offered to God. That sounds pretty clear to me. Does it say anywhere in there that it's me praying to someone in heaven and then they bring the prayer there? Or does it just simply say the prayers of the saints are brought before God? Well, when you pray, where do you think your prayers go? Do you think they go to hell? Do you think they just hit the ceiling, poof, bounce right back? When you pray, where do your prayers go? Angels present them before heaven as an incense. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. It doesn't say I pray to a saint and then he puts it before God. It says that the angel takes the prayers of the saints and puts it before God. So according to Paul, who are the saints? You and I. When we pray, what happens? Angel brings it before God. How do I know that? Just look at your Bible. Somebody say, look at your Bible. They try to lie to you. Don't believe a lie. Look at Psalm 141:2. Now, I love everybody. I love my Roman Catholic family. I love my Roman Catholic friends. I have nothing against them. But let's just get the truth to set us free. Amen? Look at what David said. Long before the book of Revelation was ever written, look at the concept here. May my prayer be set before you like incense. May the lifting up of my hands be like the evening sacrifice. David said, when I pray, may my prayers come before you like incense. Many years later, John gets a revelation, a revealing of what's in heaven. Guess what's going on in heaven? Prayers are brought before God like incense. Anything unclear about that? Does it say anywhere in the Bible to pray to a saint? No, it doesn't. These scriptures, when they're properly applied, even go back to you as a saint and give you confidence that when you pray, the Lord hears you. So in summary, everybody say, break it down. All of God's holy people who have been born again are saints, who are either on earth now doing the works of God or in heaven waiting for Jesus to return. They are not a special group of people who Christians are to pray for and make idols in their image. Saint is the predominant title for the disciples in the New Testament because God wants it to represent the restoration of the image of God in humanity. When I call you a saint, I am recognizing what was lost in the Garden of Eden to Satan has been restored because of the cross. When I call you a holy one, I am being reminded that you are made in the image of God, not an ape, not an animal. You are made in the image of God. When I recognize you as a saint in Chicago, I am required to treat you as I would Jesus. When you consider yourself a saint, you then hold yourself to a higher standard. You then believe who God says you are. You then can come to him in faith and receive the resources that he has for the saints. Can I hear an amen? Then you can do the work of the saints. Somebody say, work it. Let me just show you again here in Ephesians chapter 4, another part of Paul's writing here, same book. And he talks about why we have the church and what the church does for us and how we are to use the church for the building up of the body of Christ. And look at this right here. He gave some as apostles. That's what Paul is. Some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers. That's who's going to do the work of the church for the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the body of Christ be built up, for the body of Christ to be built up until we all attain to the unity of faith. You see, that's why you need us in your life as pastors and leaders, not to give you pep talks, but to build you up. To build you up. Do you see that? Do I build you up by patting you on the head, just keep calling you a sinner? Well, you're just a little sorry little sinner, and that's why you act like a sinner. You're nothing more, nothing less but a little sinner. Just drop your offering in our buckets. I'll keep giving you things to listen to, and I'll keep telling you how I love you coming here, but you're just a little sinner, and I don't expect anything more from you. Is that what the Bible says? No, I'm to come to you as a saint and equip you. Build you up. And what am I equipping you with? I'm equipping you with the Word of God. And so how many of you, without raising hands, without getting upset and storming out here to go see Father Tom in protest, but how many of you are a little bit upset that you've been bamboozled about who a saint is? I mean, on the inside, doesn't that just fire you up a little bit? You mean the whole time I've been reading the Bible and they've been saying saints, that was about me? You made me think that that was St. Bartholomew. Come on, how many just get a little fired up? You mean the whole entire time I was listening to K-Love and listening to Another Tear in My Beer kind of worship song? You mean I didn't have to put up with that mess? You mean I could have had joy? I could have put on the garment of praise? I could have had my broken heart healed? I could have been set free from a prison? Instead of sitting in here clanking on the prison wall with a cup, going against that prison wall. You know what I'm talking about. The bars, clank, clank, clank. I could have been set free. How many get a little upset right now? You've been bamboozled. You've been hoodwinked. You've been had. Wake up. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, I'm woke. Come on, get woke. You know who you are now. No one can tell you otherwise. Amen. This is a revolution of an identity in Christ. Now, you may say, Pastor, I don't know if I believe all that. Well, let's go to the Bible and let's see if you can believe the Bible. Amen. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14 says this. Let's read this first part, 4 by 1 together. 1, 2, 3. For by one offering he has perfected for all times those who are made holy. So in practical terms, he's literally saying, for by one offering, Jesus has perfected for all time those who are made saints, those who are made holy. When you are a Christian, you are made holy. That's what it means to be born again. In John chapter 3, Jesus told a very religious man, unless you're born again of the Spirit, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. You cannot experience God. So when I was born a sinner. Yes, I was, just like everybody, just like you, just like Paul, just like the Pope. But when we come to the one offering of the cross, and we say, Jesus, I was a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. Would you change me and make me your son or daughter? What happens? At that time, I am made a saint, and then for all time, I remain a saint. For how much time? All time. Has perfected for all time. What does the word perfect mean? Some people get thrown off by the word perfect because they think that means they know everything about everything. That's not what the Bible says Christians are. We're not know-it-alls. We don't know everything. We have to learn and gain information. And then sometimes people think that the word perfect in the Bible means that we don't make mistakes. That's not what it means. What perfect means is whole and complete. If you make a perfect pie, the pie has the perfect amount of ingredients. When you look at a Christian, you're looking at someone that has everything they need to be a new creation. That's why they're a Christian, a Christ-like person. They are like Jesus. In their soul and spirit, there are no more missing puzzle pieces. There are no more broken issues. The issue has been solved. Does that mean they always live like it? No. Does that mean they always believe it? No. You can tell me I'm not acting perfect when I don't act the right way. You can tell me I don't act holy when I sin. You have permission. You have permission to do that for your neighbor. Look at your neighbor, say, I'll keep you accountable. But what you don't have permission to do is to tell me what I am or what I am not. That is what Jesus said I am and what I am not. And when I was born again, I was made a new creation. All things had passed away. Behold, everything became new. Everything became new. In Christ Jesus, I was perfected for all time. I don't have missing parts of my soul. I had a tore-up soul when I met Jesus. I was broken and hurting, just like that song talked about. But when I met Jesus, he healed me. And that's where you grow in your Christianity. Being perfect in Christ doesn't mean you don't have maturity and growth. Just because my son is a perfect DNA specimen of my son, he is not anything less than my son. There's not one part missing from him being a Wyrostic. He has what is there for the DNA. If I was on the Maury Povich show, he would say, this is your son. That's what he would say. This is your son. That's done. That's a perfect thing. Just like you can understand that concept. I am a perfect son of God. There is nothing missing between me and God. There's no more sacrifices that have to be made. No more prayers that have to be made. I am a perfect son of God. You are a perfect righteous daughter of God. That's what the word holy means. It sounds like the word whole, W-H-O-L-E. It sounds like that, but that's not necessarily where the word comes from. But they are similar, and it's good to see it that way. Holy means separate, set apart, perfect, and righteous. And then whole means complete, not missing anything. So a good way to combine perfection and holiness together is to look at it this way. I am holy, holy. W-H-O-L-E-Y, H-O-L-Y. I am holy, completely holy, perfectly holy. Is anybody listening to me? Now, some of you want to think of it like this, and I understand because I'm a pastor, and I'm used to people not listening to me, and I'm used to people thinking about whatever they think about when it comes to the Bible and making up stuff as they go along. And so here's how it's basically going to come down to. You're either going to believe in a form of progressive salvation, or you're going to believe in complete salvation. You're going to believe something along the lines of what you were taught. Well, I'm not really that bad of a person, but if I do more good than my bad, I'll get to heaven, and I'm a good person. You will fall into that lie, or you believe that I am a good person now, that I am a holy person now, that Christ Jesus has made me righteous now. Do you understand? There's a big difference. Some of you will see yourself being birthed, as we say, born again, like, boom, I came out, I'm born again. Some of you will find yourself 20 years stuck in the birth canal of being born again. Like, I'm coming. Here's my finger. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm going to be a new person. 20 years later, I'm going to get my leg out. You know, see, we believe in complete salvation. We believe in instantaneous salvation. We believe the moment we confess Jesus, we're saved. Progressive salvation on this side focuses on self-effort. Well, I'll do better. I'll do better. I'll try harder. Makes little of the gospel. Probably don't even know what the gospel is. The gospel means Jesus died on the cross so you could live. It enjoys sin. makes excuses for sin, misuses God's grace to live holy. Well, don't Christians teach I can be forgiven? Well, I can sin as much as I want then and be forgiven, right? See, they misuse the grace of God. They justify their sin by comparison. Well, I'm not as bad as so-and-so. I'm not as bad as so-and-so. I at least go to church. I read my Bible every now and then. They neglect God's word. They listen to Oprah Winfrey instead of the Bible on what it means to be holy. It's powerless against sin and temptation. They'll say, well, I tried that. I tried it, but it didn't work. You know why? You know why you failed at Christianity? Is because you failed. Christianity didn't fail. You did it wrong. Stop doing it wrong. Stop doing a broken version of Christianity. Do the right version of Christianity, and it will work every time. Amen? Gives the devil too much credit. Oh, the devil's working on me. Devil's doing this to me. Oh, the devil's messing. Oh, El Diablo. The Bible says for the Christian, the devil's under our feet. The Bible says he's a toothless foe that's been vanquished. All he can do is roar and make a lot of noise, but he's a defeated lion. Now the lion of the tribe of Judah has conquered him. Lacks true faith, but is religious. See, when I talk like this, it's hard for you to believe. But I talk to you about some weeping statue somewhere off somewhere else. You'd be like, oh, I believe that. Oh, I believe that this water stain under a bridge is so real. You will be superstitious, but not true in faith. You'll get your tarot cards read. You'll go read the horoscope. You'll go listen to somebody talk about a dream where their Aunt Mima visited them and gave them a message, but you won't believe the actual word of God. The words where Jesus said, be ye perfect, for your heavenly Father is perfect. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are you neglect those things for man-made traditions. You'll find others to agree with you. Well, I'm not coming back to that church. I'm going to go back over here to Father Tom and Pastor so-and-so who tells me I'm just as much of a sinner as he is. They complain they're weak all the time. Well, I just can't. I can't. I tried and I can't. I tried and I can't. Once again, you're doing it wrong. I don't try to be a Christian. I am a Christian because of Christ in me. My son doesn't have to try to be my son. He's my son because I put some DNA up in my wife and my wife pushed him out. I've been born of the Spirit, birth of God. God did all the pushing. Amen. I'm here now. Praise God. Complains they are weak, cynicals of others. And here's the last but not least, cynical of others who live holy. Because you know people are already thinking in their mind, well, I know that pastor ain't perfect. I know he got mistakes. He's trying to tell me he's a holy person. I know he's not holy. Go ask his wife when's the last time he yelled at the kids. Go. I just told you that my perfect behavior, it does not determine my perfect nature. The perfect nature was given when I was born again. The behavior comes out of my belief and realization in who I am. My son may not behave perfectly like a Wirostic, but he is a perfect Wirostic. Do you know the difference? A difference between behavior and identity. I be a child of God, and I will then live like a child of God. I don't try to do to become a child of God. All of the other things are the opposite. We focus on Jesus' work when you believe in complete salvation. You make the gospel big. It's not me. It's Christ. You enjoy righteousness. You're not upset you can't sin. You love living for Jesus. You live holy by God's grace. You repent of sin quickly in your conscience. You know the truth. You abide in God's words. You defeat sin and temptation with the word of God. He said we should pray, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. Is Jesus a liar or did he teach you how to pray? He said, that's how you pray with sin. Some of you, instead of saying, Lord, lead me out of temptation, you're like running into it, like, and then you go up to like a high dive, you bounce up on that sin. I'm going to do a triple backflip right into all this sin. You're not running away from sin. Come on, somebody. Abides in God's word, defeats sin and temptation, considers the devil already defeated. We know he's defeated. Lives by faith, rejects false religion. That's why I don't have to come in here with smells and bells wearing a robe. I know who I am in Christ. Amen? I'll dress just like Jesus did. I'll dress just like Peter. They were ordinary men. You ever seen a fisherman dress up in a three-piece suit? Come on, somebody. That's who Jesus picked was fishermen. Loves correction and accountability. Show me when I am not acting as who I'm supposed to be. Proclaims they are strong in Christ, not in themselves, but in Christ. This is not a self-help religion. This is a God-empowered relationship. They desire and pray to live holy. God, I want to be who you called me to be. Do you see the difference? Now, when you put it together, this is kind of like how it looks like when you run into people, because this is how they're going to see it. They're going to see themselves in some process. If they don't believe that God made them who he said they are, they're going to believe in some kind of a process like this right here. I got the wrong link coming up, but you guys can see it. They're going to say, okay, you know, like Hitler, he was 0% saved. Like he was definitely going to hell with the devil. Okay, we know that. But you know what? My next door neighbor, they're about 10% saved. They're still 90% crazy. But my neighbor, they're about 10%. They're not as bad as the Hitler, right? How many got some neighbors that you would say they're about 10% saved, you know? And then you would say, like, my coworker, my boss, they're about 20% saved. They're getting there. They need to go to church more. And then this is how you will look at religion and Christianity. I'm just the little engine that could. Choo-choo, I'm just the little engine that could. And you're just going to think all through life, God is still working on me. Second flesh, chapter 2, verse 11. God is still working on me. And one day, I'll be who he wants me to be because nobody's perfect. And that's how you'll see yourself. And so honestly, if I didn't even preach what I preached today and I just started off with this, some of y'all be like, this is Christianity. Yeah, God's still working on me, pastor. And if I would just put a Bible verse, because some of y'all don't even know the Bible, if I just put like 2 Peter 2:11, you'd be like, amen, that's the Bible. He's still working on me. Ain't nobody perfect. Amen, pastor. What's wrong with that? And then if I literally had a survey go around, like, y'all tell me how saved you are. Y'all be circling like what you are. You'd ask your neighbor, how saved are you? About 70% saved. I'm getting there. Seriously. And then your wife would say, no, you about 60. You just barely made it over half. I guarantee you, if I go to any church today and preach this message, they're like, amen. And then if I started whooping and hollering, you can do it. By God's grace, you can go from 70 to 80% saved. You can do it. I know you can do it. Y'all would be clapping. Oh, I can do it. I know I can do it. Yeah. We'd all get excited. Just be like, you gonna do it? You gonna do it? Is that how the Bible talks? Is that what Jesus said? Well, I'm gonna start off with you, Peter, and I'm gonna work you and work you and work you until you finally get there. And when you're about 90% saved, I'm gonna take you to heaven and then complete you up there. Is that what it says? No, he said, you are saved here. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:17. That's the real Bible. That's Paul the apostle talking. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, the new creation has come. Downloaded. Boom, bing. It's there. Not waiting on a slow DSL speed. Not waiting for that phone to download it. No, new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. Where is the new? Come on, right here. Point to yourself and say, the new me is here. I'm not waiting for it. I'm not in a self-help religion. I don't got to join some yoga class where yoga pants, be a vegetarian, and do the crooked chicken to earn another 5% towards heaven. I've already been born again. The new is here. Now live like the new you. Live like you've been born again. Live like you've been changed. Live like who God says he is real on the inside of you. Can I get an amen? Now that's technically the second introduction. So that's technically the second introduction. I got the message right after this thing right here, but I'm going to go through it really quick. Bear with me here because it's baptism day. Baptism day. Be fast, pastor. It's baptism day. We got people here that don't like what you're saying. Be fast, pastor. Baptism day. This is exactly the kind of day I wish this message would fall on. Like, I never planned this, but if I ever could plan it for all my visitors, it would be this message. I would like to now take a few moments to clarify what the Bible teaches about being and acting perfect. Being perfect in Christ is who we be in our nature. Acting perfect in Christ is what we're commanded to do. Though we may not always act perfect, we be perfect. Saying nobody is perfect has become an excuse for many Christians to continue in sin. Rather, every Christian should boldly say, I am perfected in Christ, even if I don't always act like it. The difference is understanding our nature and what is expected of us. Saying nobody is perfect gives the impression that God has not saved nor changed you. Confessing you are perfect in Christ places a demand upon your faith to live like who God made you to be like. It places a demand. You got to live up to it. When you believe you were made sinless, you will sin less. When you believe that the default state of your water bottle is perfectly pure and clean, you will get upset with every little germ, every little thing of dirt that gets in there. But if you keep thinking of yourself as a dirty old water bottle, you won't get upset with sin. Understand, God made you holy, righteous, and perfect in him. Hate sin, love that, and you will be a refreshment to those around you and to Jesus. You will be a drink offering, as the Bible says. Understand being perfect. Everybody say, I be perfect, and I'm learning to act perfect. Well, who thought I was perfect? Jesus. Jesus. Look at Matthew 5:48. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Did it say be messed up as Father Thomas messed up? Be messed up as Pastor so-and-so's messed up? No, be perfect. There it is. Boom, shakalaka. As your Heavenly Father is perfect. Whatever standard He is, be that. Well, I can't be that. Well, that's why you got to be born again. You can't do that without a spiritual new life being given to you. You won't make yourself a new person no more than you made yourself the sinner you are today. You were born by your mom and dad from the heritage of Adam and Eve. You didn't create them, you didn't make them, and you didn't choose for them to do a sin. But you were born that way because of God's sovereignty. God allowed you to be born into a fallen world. Now the choice is yours. Do you want to be born again into the kingdom of God, perfect like your Heavenly Father's perfect? The second thing is the Bible says you're supposed to be godly like God. That's what the word godly means. You ever heard the word godly? You are to be godly. 2 Peter 1:4 says, through these he has given us very great and precious promises so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped, past tense, the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. You want to escape your evil desires? How many of you have evil desires? Let's be honest. I have them. You have them. How many want to escape them? Come to the divine nature of Christ, and you will. That's what the Bible says. Run to God every time you have temptation. Stand upon who you are. Believe what the Bible says about you, and you will do what God says you can do. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16 says, be holy because I am holy. Two places he says, be something like he is. Be perfect like I am perfect. Be holy like I am holy. Ask yourself this question. Put on the brakes right now in this service. Do you believe the Bible? Do you believe you can be what he said you can be? If not, you don't really take this serious then. Jesus did what he did so I could be a holy, perfect, righteous person. That's why he did what he did. Now, what does it mean to do perfect? Everybody say, do perfect. That just means we always obey the commands of God. How many of you are good right now at being perfect and not being a murderer? Okay, any murderers in here? I'm waiting to see who's not raising their hand. Let's try this again. How many of you right now are doing good without murdering somebody? You're like, I'm perfect at not being a murderer. Okay, the rest of you not raising your hands. I got my eyes on you. I got my eyes on you. You back there, I got my... So you're already perfect in something. You're already completely the opposite of something. You're not murdering anybody right now, right? Well, all sins are thought of the same way. Be a perfect, not liar. Tell the truth. You have the same choice, just like the choice you have right now, not to murder, don't lie, don't steal. Well, what if I do? Well, repent, turn around, ask God for forgiveness, and go in the opposite direction. That's what's expected of Christians. We do it because of who God made us to be. Galatians chapter 5, verse 24 says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. When you feel temptation from your body to get angry, to get upset, sexually perverse, proud, jealous, disobedient, rebellious, count your flesh, this part of your body, crucified with Christ, and your perfect spirit free to live as God called you to live. Paul said it in another way. Make your body the slave of your spirit. You tell this body what to look at on the internet, what words to speak with the tongue, what thoughts to think inside this brain. You, my friend, are in control of yourself today. Amen? The Bible then says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 25, keep in step with the Spirit. Keep in step with the Spirit. When will I sin? When I take a step outside the Spirit. When I do what God told me not to do. What should be my default step today? Where the Spirit leads. What should be your default position? The natural position you should want to step today with your marriage, with the holiness of God, loving each other as Christ loves the church, with all your heart. Where should you be with your children? Doing the same thing. How should your children be with you? Staying in step with what you're saying. Sin is not something that happens by accident. It is a volition, a choice of the will. Choose to step into righteousness as the Lord leads you every single day. You step outside, repent, and know who you are in Christ. You were made for more than sin. Amen? And you are not sin, even if you do sin. The Bible says, my dear children, I write these things to you that you will not sin. What does John write to us? I write these to you so you will not sin. I don't want you to sin. Okay, if you want to sin, you have a problem. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, who is our atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for only ours, but for the sins of the world. Do you get that? So even though I may sin, that doesn't take me out of relationship with Jesus. I can be forgiven of my sin, and I can remain in a great relationship with him. And it's good to note this. If you ever don't want to be in that relationship, you can leave at any time because he is not a divine kidnapper. Jesus is not the kind of person that says, come over to my house, and he locks the door, deadbolts it, and says, you'll be here for a while. You can leave at any point and get out of Christ. Out, see, in him is the name of the sermon series, but you can go out of him if you want to. I choose to stay in him. And in him, my sin will not define who I am. If I sin, I will be humble enough to hear the Lord speak, and I will repent. And if I don't hear it, the Lord will tell me what I've done wrong. I mean, my wife will tell me what I've done wrong, and I'll repent. Because how many know sometimes you don't hear the Lord speaking to your heart? And that's why you need husbands and wives and parents with their children need to tell them what's right and wrong. And we do that here in church as well. How many are ready for the message now? I'll just skip through the message and let you read this on your own. I actually don't have time to preach. I wish I did. I wanted to preach out of Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. But you know what? I just want to tell you this today, that I'm glad that we're doing this message and that there's going to be a baptism today for those who understand who they are in Christ. And if you don't know who you are in Christ, you can do the right thing right now by being born again and know for sure who you are. And if you've been a Christian and you haven't followed who you are, stop. Stop stinking thinking right now. Get the junk out of the trunk and believe who God said you are. Everybody say, I believe who he said I am. I can do what he said I can do. Come on, say it again. I believe I am who he said I am. I can do what he said I can do. Now let's put some scripture on that. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Come on, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Come on, in this world I am like Jesus. I am perfect like my heavenly Father is perfect. I am holy like he is holy. I am more than a conqueror. Nothing can separate me from his love. I'm dancing with the divine. Come on. That's what it means to participate in the divine nature. I'm literally, God is the leader and I'm dancing with him. I'm following his steps. Now, if you all want to put something cool on Facebook, this is where you want to bring out your phone right now. I'm going to ask my wife to bring out hers because I got a spoken word I want to drop on you guys right now. You ready for this? So some of y'all get out your phones at different points, but this is the time to do it. If you don't want to do it, no pressure. Just enjoy it. I want to end with this so that everybody can hear it in a way that it might stick with you. It might stick with you a little bit better because I know that this goes against a lot of what we were taught, but the truth will set you free. Amen. I was born a sinner with nothing good on the inside of me. Since meeting Jesus Christ, I've been born again a saint with a righteous identity. Though the world may not see my entire sanctification, my obedience to Christ will show I'm a perfect new creation. Yes, it's true that I don't always reflect Christ in all my behavior, but that doesn't change the fact I share in his holy divine nature. The life that I now live is not based on weak excuses like nobody is perfect because that whack thinking is useless. I believe that by God's grace I was made sinless. So by that mindset I daily sin less. That's why I stay blessed. I live based on God's word and all of his promises to me in which Jesus promised, who the Son sets free is free indeed. So awake, O sleeper, and Christ will shine on you. He will raise you from the dead and make your spiritual soul brand new. Woo! Let's give it up for Jesus. That's what's up in the house of God today.